Now we would have the open question and answer session. We would request you to kindly maintain the peaceful and calm atmosphere. Dr. Zakir will be answering your questions. We would like everyone to know there's an estimated more than 100,000 people collected here. I think more than 75% are Muslims. Are they peaceful or not? Are they disciplined or not? You pick up one or two people as terrorists, you cannot present them as examples. This is an example for the people of India, for the people of the world watching on Peace TV. See, we are so well disciplined. And we can analyze our topics and debate our topics critically, realistically, and we also have open question and answer forums as now. We start with the open question and answer session, in which you are welcome to ask any question on the topic, is peace or is Islam the solution for humanity? We have three microphones arranged on the grounds, one next to the stage on my left, and one on my left in the rear section for the brothers, and we have one microphone in the rear section arranged for the sisters. The ladies can put forward the question from that microphone. Your question has to be on the topic. It must be brief and to the point. This is question time for you, not a lecture time. Please note. You may ask only one question at a time and then go back at the queue and await your second chance. As Dr. Zakir had just mentioned, we will allow non-Muslims first preference. They would have preference over Muslim brothers to put forward their question, and they can move ahead in the queue. The volunteers would help you to come in the front ahead of the Muslim brothers or sisters and put forward your question. I would request our non-Muslim brothers and sisters, feel free, feel safe. We are your brothers and sisters in analyzing this topic. We are your protectors. We are your custodians for this lecture in a very peaceful manner. May we have the first question from the ladies section. The sisters will give them a first chance. And you may kindly state your name and profession before putting forward your question so that Dr. Zakir can give a more appropriate and relevant response. Yes, sister.
I'm Mrs. Bhavna Ansari. So kindly please bear with me and please excuse me humbly and peacefully. I have been born in a Jain society, living in a Hindu society, educated in a pure convent, and married a Muslim. I have married as per the Indian Marriage Act, and I'm staunchly, eagerly waiting to accept Islam as my wholehearted religion. But please, my brothers and sisters, what you preached, what you said about Islam, I'm very thankful to you for enlightening me. I am really reborn today. But what you preach and what you say and what is in Islam, excuse me, I don't find people practicing that wholeheartedly. They are not attracting me. Can you please give me a solution? Because when you speak of fundamentalism in Islam, it is positive. When you speak of intolerance, it's positive. But in practice, I don't find. So can you please guide me?
Sister has asked a very good question. First of all, I'd like to congratulate her, and I welcome her. And as she says, she's reborn. The right word in Islam is revert. Because according to our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, every child is born in Dhin al-Fitr, is born as a Muslim. Muslim means a person who submits his will to Almighty God. Every human being, initially, when he's born, he submits his will to Almighty God. Later on, the Prophet said that he's influenced by the parents, by the elders, by the teachers. Then he may become a fire worshipper, may go on the wrong track. So therefore, when a person comes back to the original faith, to Din al-Fitr. The right word is not convert, not reborn, it is revert. So, sister, I welcome you back to this faith of peace and submitting your will to Almighty God. As far as question is concerned, that you have heard the lectures and you agree with the points, you have read about Islam, but your own objection is that Muslims, or most of the Muslims according to you, they are not following the teachings. What is the solution? Sister, I do agree with you. I do agree with you that many don't follow, but according to statistics, the religion which is the maximum followed, I'm not talking in numbers. If you count the heads, those who profess a religion, number one would be Christianity, somewhere close to 2 billion. Islam, 1.3 billion to 1.4 billion. But the percentage which practices and follows the religion, maximum is Islam, number one. Maximum. But yet, I do agree with you that in terms of numbers, because 1.3 billion followers, even if it be a small percentage, the numbers will run in millions of Muslims don't follow the religion. Therefore, sister, to understand Islam, don't look at Muslims, please. And I always say, to understand a religion, don't look at the followers of the religion, but look at the authentic sources. Please don't look at me. Don't look at the Muslims around you. And I gave you the example of the car and the driver. If you want to know how good the car is, and if a person who does not know how to drive sits behind the steering wheel and he has an accident, he bangs up the car, who will you blame, the car or the driver? You'll blame the driver. So please don't understand Islam by looking at the Muslims. That's the reason we are giving these lectures, for both Muslims and non-Muslims alike. Those Muslims who have shortcomings, we are trying to get them closer to the truth. Because they may be namesake Muslims, we are trying to make them practicing Muslim. At the same time, we are delivering the message of Islam to the non-Muslims also, so that you understand this religion. And though you were born in a Jain family, and you had non-Muslim around you, you're married to a Muslim, but today, maybe after hearing the lecture, and after learning about Islam, you have come back to the faith. And as you said that previously, maybe only for the sake of name, you may have adopted the surname Ansari, but today you have come back to this true faith, and we congratulate you. And please, sister, if you want to look at a Muslim to understand Islam, the best example is the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. This book, the Quran, and the sayings of the Prophet have the solution for the problems of humanity. Don't look at the Muslims. Some Muslims may be close to Islam, some may be far away from Islam. So look at the main source. Understand it, follow it. Inshallah, you'll get peace in this world as well as the hereafter.
Inshallah. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sister, for your question. Yes, brother.
Sir, my name is Professor Sethi. I am an engineer by profession, and I'm into a teaching profession. By God's grace, I'm very strong in my maths. To start with, I appreciate your hard work and pray to God to give you double your age God has allotted you. And I thank all the Muslims here for giving me first priority to ask my question. Sir, I've gone through Bhagavad Gita, I've gone through Ramayana. Being Hindu, I was after temples and everything. But my brother-in-law is a Muslim. He gave me Quran. I've gone through it twice. And I can say in open, I'm following your Quran very strictly. I've converted your namaz into English. In the name of God, the most gracious and the most merciful, the creator, cherisher, sustainer of the worlds, the master of the day of judgment. I'm reading it 12 times, 15 times, 20 times. I don't see timings. I just stand and pray to God. And I'm very satisfied with that. The only one question, I'm not getting it, my source of income. Being very strong in maths, I am also a technical analyst with stock market. I am very strong with F&O market, future and option. I don't know how many people understand the stock market here. With a very intellectual mathematics and very intellectual playing the game, I am always secure and always in profit after the end of the month. It's a mathematic game which people don't understand. Is it okay to go ahead with such income? I'm suffering from this last 3 years. I'm earning money, I can earn money, whatever level I want to earn. But I don't want to earn anything wrong. If it is wrong, I will leave that forever. And I will go into teaching profession forever.
Alhamdulillah.
The brother asked a very good question, and I appreciate that after reading the Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, and the Hindu scriptures, he read the Quran twice, and he agrees with it. He has a brother-in-law who's a Muslim, and he's very strong in maths. And even I happen to be strong in maths. And in school days, right from standard 1 to standard 9, 10, always bagged the prize.
Without saying, sir, mind-boggling memory, I've never seen a person like you. It's and God if God grace, I will be at your place forever. If the God, agar Ishwar ki marzi hui, Allah ki marzi hui, to aapka shish banunga isi platform par.
Inshallah, inshallah. Inshallah. First, I'll come to the question and then, inshallah, I'll reply to his last comment. As far as your question is concerned, that you are in the stock market about futures and options, etc., and you are so good in maths and analyzing that always at the end of the month you make a profit. So the question is that, is this earning halal or haram? As far as the stock market is concerned, stock per se is not haram, per se. As long as the stocks you deal in, it is according to the guidelines of Islam. What is haram in Islam is riba. It's interest. There are many verses in the Quran, no less than 8 different places, Almighty God says in the Quran that riba is haram. In Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 130. In Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 161. In Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 275 thrice. In Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 276. As well as in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 278. It says that give up your demands of riba, of interest, of usury. And those who do not give up the demands of riba and usury, verse number 279, Allah says, take notice of Allah from Allah and His Rasul, Allah and His Messenger. So dealing in interest is haram. But share market is somewhat following the principles of Islam of profit and loss sharing. Share per se, instead of taking a loan from the bank, we make partners. Because the banking system makes a rich person more rich, poor person more poor. It encourages things evil in society. Like in 80s, the banks fund gambling dens, alcohol bars. An Islamic system is different. Islamic banking is different. So Islam encourages profit and loss sharing. In the stock market, what do? That you buy a share. So you become a partner in that company. Whether 1%, 10%, 0.1%, 0.01%. So being partner in profit and loss sharing is encouraged in Islam. So if you're dealing in stock market and shares, as long as it is within the purview of the Islamic Sharia, as long as you do not buy shares of a company which deals in alcohol, company which deals in interest, financial companies, whether it be banks, whether financial instrument companies, company which deals in media obscenity, pornography. So all the evils of society, if the company you invest in is not investing in the evil of society, alcoholism or drugs or pharmaceutical companies allowed, huh? Drugs means cocaine and brown sugar, or dealing with obscenity, it may be film industry. So if you buy shares of these companies, it's haram. Secondly, if you involved in speculation, that is gambling, you know, you being in the stock market, people buy now, after 2 minutes again they sell because of prior information or because of, you know, so gambling is prohibited in Islam. So if your stock market is good, you want to invest in it, you want to stay for good, be a partner, make, and even I'm involved in stock market. And
so you're not replying to the right point I'm asking. It is futures and options. It is put
I'm
in call.
I'm coming to it.
You can just pay 10 rupees and buy stocks for 100 rupees and you keep it for years and years, years together.
I'm coming to it.
Yes, sir.
I like giving a holistic reply rather than...
Okay. Thanks a lot, sir. Sorry for disturbing.
Now coming to the futures option, that you buy part of the shares and you deal with it, etc. Talking about futures, if you pay part and have it with you, I know you can sell, then you can have security on that. Then there's another person with the derivatives, which can even, I know about this. I may not be an expert like you, but even this is. So dealing in futures, it's not permitted. It's not. Margin trading in certain things like real estate, you buy 10% of that and then it increases because you have to make timely payment. If you buy a flat, suppose, the payment time is 2 years, you pay 10% now, 20% later, the rates go up, you sell, that's fine. But in shares, it doesn't work like that. In futures, it doesn't work like that. So because you don't possess it in your hands, You have paid part of the money, and then someone else backs you up, that if it goes down, then they hedge it. You know, hedging. They hedge it. So all these things are not permitted in Islam. But pure stock, as long as the thing which you deal in, if it is Islamic, it's allowed. And you ask me the question, that all these things that you get a large money income. If it's not allowed, you wouldn't like it. See, the money that you earn, as you said, if it's not permitted, you stop it. So what we are interested in peace in this world and the akhirah. The peace in the next world is a longer peace. So if you're earning the halal, inshallah, you'll get good in this world as well as in the akhirah. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your peace and success in this world as well as in the akhirah, in the next world. Hope that answers the question.
Thanks, Lord. Thanks, Lord. I appreciate it for giving you so much of time. And definitely, I will be following it strictly, sir. Thank you.
Yes, brother.
My name is Abhishek. When I was 14, I ran from my home, fighting my family. A man from Saudi take me to Kerala. He teach me Islam. 2 years before, I accepted Islam. Now also I am accepting in Islam in front of all. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh.
Your question, brother? Any question you have for Dr. Zakir?
No, sir.
Dr. Zakir would like to comment on that.
Dear brother, I welcome you and I congratulate you to the religion of peace. And surely you can testify that no sword was used by that Saudi. Did he use any sword on you, brother?
No.
Any force?
No.
Any gun?
No. Otherwise, I accepted from my heart.
Masha, otherwise the IB will question me. MashaAllah. I would like to give you a translation of the Quran, if you can come on the stage. Because I remember the first time I gave a talk 8 days back, there was a sister there who accepted Islam. Believe me, I can't see the face. I can only see the face of the questioner who's on my left. On the first mic. I can't see your face. I can't see the face of the lady you accepted on the first day, on Saturday. The IB came questioning the intelligence that where is that lady? I said, I don't even know her face. Maybe on the television you saw her. The gathering is so vast. So surely the people on the television see your face, haven't seen your face. So you can testify to the people that there was no force used on you and no one can use force on you to accept Islam. If you like it with your heart, and this country of ours, this country, India, is one of the few countries in the world in whose constitution is mentioned that every citizen of India has the right to preach, practice, and propagate his religion. It is a democratic country, but I'm proud of this country that we have the right to preach, practice, and propagate religion. Forcing anyone to accept any religion is prohibited. Is not only prohibited in the Indian government law, it is prohibited even in Islam. You can't force anyone to accept the religion of Islam. You deliver the message, if he accepts, good. If he doesn't accept, also no problem. Because we can at least testify to Almighty God on the Day of Judgment that we delivered the message of peace to you. Thank you, brother, for accepting the religion of peace. Thank you very much.
Yes, any sister on the mic?
Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Pooja. I'm a physiotherapist. Sir, during your oration, you said these lines. I would just like to repeat them. You said, every person who is an extremist Muslim, the problems of the humanity will be solved. I would just like to make a correction. I'm too young to correct you. Sorry for that. But from the core of my heart, I believe this sentence would have been more authentic if we put it this way. Every person who is an extremist, the problems of the humanity will be solved. Mesoever, he is a Muslim, a Hindu, a Christian, whosoever.
Dr. Pooja has asked a very good question. And sister, if I'm wrong, I'm ready to accept the mistake. The question answer is meant for that. If I say by mistake 2 plus 2 is equal to 5, you have a right to correct me. It's not 5, it's 4. I'm a human being. I'm not a human computer, I'm a human being, I can make mistakes. That's the reason we have open question answer session. But, coming to your comment, I said that if everyone would have an extremist Muslim, the problem would have solved. And you corrected me by saying that if we would have said that every human being would have been an extremist, the problem would have solved. Extremist in which way?
The way you said, to be extremely kind, extremely lovable.
Sister, if you heard my talk, I said an extremist Muslim is a person who's extremely kind, extremely merciful, extremely loving, extremely honest, extremely just. Otherwise, they can be an extremist robber who wants to rob. They can be an extremist rapist. So if I just say extremist, the problem will be solved. The rapist will be happy with me. They say I'm an extremist rapist, you know. So sister, if you translate the full into English, you'll understand more correctly. What I meant was that if every human being becomes an extremist Muslim, means if every human being becomes an extremist, peaceful person, submitting his will to God, then the problems of humanity will be solved. Now, because I use the Arabic word, it does not go down the throats of many people. I'm not talking about you, sister.
No.
I'm talking about the media. When I say Islam, Muslim, it doesn't go down the throat. So I would like to rephrase the question for the benefit of the non-Muslims. If every human being becomes an extremely peaceful person, submitting his will to Almighty God, the problems of humanity will be solved.
Mesoever he is Muslim, Hindu, or Christian.
Now, if you add mesoever is Hindu, Muslim, Christian, rapist, robber, then the formula doesn't work, sister. Because if you say mesoever he be a Muslim, if he submits his will to Almighty God, he has to be a Muslim.
And if a Hindu submits to God, he is not
very
acceptable
good.
By God.
No.
Not like that.
Yes, sister, wait, let me. You ask a second question, I give a second answer.
No, sir.
You are perfectly right. What is the definition of the word Hindu, sister? Hindu is a geographical definition, meaning those people living in the land of India. In that definition, I'm a Hindu, sister. I'm a Hindu Muslim by geographical definition. But this word Hindu was first used by the Arabs when they came to India. When I go to Saudi Arabia, they say Hindu, you know? So this Hindu actually is a geographical definition, but today it is used as a misnomer to describe as a religion. According to Swami Vivekananda, he says that the followers should actually be called as Vedantist because they follow the Vedas. So Hindu is a misnomer. You ask any scholar. So if you say, can a Hindu be a Muslim? Geographical definition, I am a Hindu, I am living in India, I submit my will to God, I am a peaceful person. But sister, even the Americans can be good. Even the English can be good. If I say everyone in the world should live in India, as it is there is population, as it is more than 1 billion people.
I would like to reframe my question,
sister,
sir.
Please let me complete the answer. You asked a question, I'm giving the answer. We'll give you a second chance, no problem, sister. Surely. But at least let me clarify. Therefore, the words that you use, you should understand the meaning of the word. If every human being should live in India, then the Indian government will have a problem. As it is, they say, hum do hamare do, ek ke baad abhi nahi, do ke baad kabhi nahi. They're talking about family planning. We two and our two. Hum do hamare do, ek ke baad abhi nahi, do ke baad kabhi nahi. Means after one, let there be a gap. After two, you should not at all produce. Family planning, you can hear my answer in Quran Modern Science. So sister, therefore the words that you speak, if it's not in English, people sometimes have confusion. So if you're a Hindu, submitting a will to God, submitting and following the Vedas. If you see my talk, sister, on similarities between Islam and Hinduism, the Vedas say that you should believe in one God. If you follow the Vedas, it's mentioned in Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1. It says that Ikkam Evidityam, God is only one without a second. It's mentioned in the Veda, Yajurveda, chapter number 32, verse number 3, Na tasya pratimasti, of that God, there is no pratima. Pratima means image, statue, sculpture, photograph. Of that Almighty God, according to Veda, there are no images, there are no photographs, there are no sculptures, there are no statues. If you are such a Hindu, it's mentioned in the Veda of another messenger to come, the final messenger, whose name is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He is prophesied in the Kalki Avatar, chapter number 2, verse number 5, verse number 7, verse number 9, verse number 11, verse number 15, that this Kalki Avatar, he will be born in the city of peace, that is Makkah. His father's name shall be Vishnu, Yash, servant of God, translated Abdullah, which was the name of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, father. His mother's name shall be Sumati, means peaceful, serenity. In Arabic, it's Amina, which was the name of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's mother. He will be born on 12th month of Madhav. We know he was born on 12th of Biawal. He'll have four companions, the first for Khulafa Rashidin. I can go on and on and on. I've given a lecture on similarities between Islam and Hinduism. What I say, sister, that let us agree that at least one book is the word of God. Hindus will say that the Veda is the word of God. Christian will say Bible is the word of God. Muslim will say Quran is the word of God. Let us at least agree to follow what is common in the scriptures. Come to common terms as we nas in you. Now what is not common, sister, let's not fight on that. We'll discuss that tomorrow. Fine? So let us agree, all the religious scriptures, all the major religious scriptures, whether it be the Bible, whether it be the Veda, whether it be the Quran, whether it be the Parsi scriptures, whether it be the Sikh scriptures, they say you have to believe in one God. Most of the major religions, they prophesize the coming of the last and final messenger. It's mentioned even in the Bible, in Deuteronomy chapter number 18, verse number 18, book of Deuteronomy chapter number 18, verse number 19, in the book of Isaiah chapter number 29, verse number 12, it's prophesied in the Song of Solomon chapter number 5, verse number 16, in the New Testament Gospel of John chapter number 14, verse number 16, in the Gospel of John chapter number 15, verse number 26, in the Gospel of John chapter number 16, verse number 7, in the Gospel of John chapter number 16, verse number 12, 14, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hears shall he speak. So what we come to know from all these major scriptures, that you have to believe in one God, who has got no images, who has got no idols. You have to believe in the last and final messenger. So let us agree, sister. Let's not fight on the differences. Let's agree to follow what is common in the Hindu scriptures, in the Parsi scriptures, in the Christian scriptures, you're talking Hindu-Muslim, I'm talking about Parsiism, I'm talking about Islam. Let us agree to follow what's common, and inshallah, all the human beings who believe in God, they'll have to agree there's one God who has got no images, who has got no statues, and have to believe that one last and final messenger has to come, whose name is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then we will have, every human being should be an extremely peaceful person, submitting his will to Almighty God, then the problems of humanity will be solved. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
We have brother Abhishek, who had just asked the previous question. He's already at the back of the stage, and he doesn't want to miss the opportunity to receive Quran from Dr. Zakir Naik. We allow him to accept it. Takbir! The brother came at the back of the stage and he was requesting the volunteers, I would like to receive. Alhamdulillah, we said we accept it. Yes, brother, the next question.
Zakir bhai, main Hindi mein question karega. Ye jo idhar bahut Muslim bhai aur behne, to unka feelings hurt hoega, to main maafi chahta. Mera naam hai Mahesh Mehta, aur main businessman hu. Ye jo Quran hai, wo Khuda ki bheji hui kitab nahi hai. Kyon? Kyonki ये जो तोरेत जबूर इंजील जो भेजा तोरेत मूसा अलैहि सलाम को भेजा जबूर दाऊद अलैहि सलाम को भेजा और ईसा अलैहि सलाम को तो इंजील दिया तो ये अभी जो प्रेजेंट फॉर्म में नहीं है तीनों किताब ये लोग ने गड़बड़ कर दिया ऐसा बोलते हैं मुस्लिम जो भी आप लोग दूसरा बात ये भी है कि जो कुरान में पीपल ऑफ द बुक पीपल ऑफ द बुक कई बार कहते हैं यहूदी लोग और ईसाई लोग को तो जो जो अपना अल्लाह रहेगा तो खुद अपना मैसेज देगा जैसा कृष्णा भगवद गीता में बोलता है ये करो ये नहीं करो तो ये किताब कोई आदमी ने लिखा है और जो 25 जो प्रॉफेट्स हैं जो बाइबल में हैं पूरे वो सब वही कुरान में है तो ये क्या है ये जो अभी जो इतना बड़ा अल्लाह है जो पूरा यूनिवर्स उसने बनाया है तो ये बात नहीं बोलेगा कि ये यहूदी लोग ये ईसाई लोग मतलब यहूदी ईसाई लोग को भी वो जानता था ये आदमी का ही काम है मेरे हिसाब से ऐसा मुझे लगता है एंड आई वांट टू आस्क अदर क्वेश्चन आल्सो वन मिनट यू नो आई ट्रैवल टू
लेट हिम आंसर द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन देन वी विल अलाउ योर सेकंड वन ब्रदर
ब्रदर आस्क द क्वेश्चन ही सेज एंड आई नो महेश भाई ही हैज बीन कमिंग टू आईआरएफ सिंस 1991 एंड ही टेक्स मोर वीडियो कैसेट्स फ्रॉम आईआरएफ इवन देन द मुस्लिम्स So his list in IRF, taking maximum number of video cassettes, literature, etc. Mahesh asked the question that as the earlier scriptures, as the Quran says, Torah, Zabur, Injil, revealed to Moses, David, Jesus Christ, peace be upon them, that the Muslims say it has changed. So in the Quran, when the Quran speaks about the Jews, that, oh, people of the book, Jews and Christians. So when it speaks about in such a way, so isn't the Quran also written by the human beings? Correct? Your argument is that how does it speak about the Jews and Christians? Brother, if you had come for my earlier talk, is the Quran God's word? Were you there for the talk?
No, I was not.
That talk dealt with this topic in detail. I don't intend repeating the full talk. And it dealt in detail that how people allege Prophet Muhammad wrote it, being a human being, for what reason, for power, for gain, etc. And a 2 hours lecture, which I can't repeat. But coming to your main question, that because it says that, oh, people of the book, it's telling, so that means it indicates written by a human being. Brother, if you analyze in the Quran, as you rightly said, that there are 25 messengers mentioned my name. And most of the messengers mentioned of Almighty God, they are Jewish. And if you see these names also mentioned in the Bible, about more than one third of the Quran is addressed to the Jews. Why? Giving examples that Almighty God did favors to the people of Israel, Ya Bani Israel. Don't you know the favors we did unto you, but you did so and so thing. So these are examples given in the Quran by Almighty God, that there were prophets who came earlier to these people. Some people rejected the prophet, some people accepted the prophet. So when it is giving an example, it says, Kul, Ya Ahl al-Kitab, say, O people of the book, Ta'ala wila kalmitin sawa imbayna bainakum. Come to common terms as been asked you. So the Quran is telling us Muslims that you have to speak to the people of the book. People of the book means people of the revelation. Indicating in this Quran specifically, when the word people of the book is used, it is referring to Yahud and Nasara, to the Jews and the Christians. So Allah is telling the Muslims to talk to the Ahl Kitab. Allah also says, Ya Ahl Kitab, O people of the book. So that means Quran is addressing not only to the Muslims, or to the Arabs, but to the Ahl Kitab also. Therefore, I mentioned that this last and final revelation, the glorious Quran, was not sent only for the Muslims or the Arabs, it was sent for the whole of humanity. If it was a human work, as you say, then Almighty God will never mention that, go and ask the Jews and Christians. It is mentioned in the scriptures. At that time, there were many who did not know about the Jews and Christians, what happened in the past. When they checked up, it turned out to be true. Further, it says, it talks even about prophecies, that what's going to happen in the future. So all these things, brother, it cannot be the work of a human being. For more details, you can refer to my talk, Is the Quran God's Word? Hope that answers the question.
I travel more than 55 countries, and Quran and Hadith, they prohibit the idol worship. But you go, you other religion, Christianity, Buddhism, and Chinese religion, Jainism, all other religion, they have idol worship. And you know, Muslim, maybe they are 15-20% in this world, total, percentage-wise. And so other people are wrong. You know, Christian, 1 minute, any Anglican church or Russian Orthodox or Greek Orthodox or Catholic or Protestants, you know, Chinese, they have the big statue of the God. So all they are wrong.
Brother asked a very good question. He's saying the Muslims are approximately 15-20%. Some say 25%. Whatever it is, you say 15%, 20%, I've got no problem. So he's telling that Christians, they do idol worship. Fine, I agree with you. He says that Buddhism create big statue. What do you think they're wrong? Brother, the majority doesn't win in Islam. In Islam, the truth prevails. The majority people a couple of hundred years ago said the world was flat. Majority. Do you know that? Majority of the people few hundred years back said the world is flat. Is the world flat, Brother Mahesh?
No.
So majority people can be wrong. In Islam, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 81, وَقُلْ جَالْ حَقَّ وَزَاقَ الْبَاطِلْ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ قَانَ زَوْكَ. Say that truth has arrived and falsehood perish. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. Therefore, in Islam, majority never wins. If you go to America, in America, pornography is legalized. Do you believe in pornography?
No, so many European countries.
Do you believe in pornography, Brother Mahesh?
I don't believe.
No, very good human being. I congratulate you. But the majority of people in Western world believe in pornography. So will you believe in pornography? Will you see pornography? Very good. Good boy. See, You are close to the truth. So majority never wins. As far as you say, in Christianity, idol worship is there. In Christianity, idol worship is not there. Christians do idol worship. Like some Muslims do wrong things. If you read the Christian Bible, which you have read the Christian Bible, I'm sure, it's mentioned in the Bible, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 5. Verse number 7, 8 and 9, thou shalt not have any graven image of me, Almighty God. He's telling in the Old Testament, thou shalt have no graven image of me, of anything, of any likeness in the heaven above, in the earth beneath, and the water beneath the earth. Thou shalt not serve them, nor bow down to them, for I, thy God, thy Lord, is a jealous God. Same message repeated in the book of Exodus. Chapter number 20, verse number 3 to 5, that thou shalt have no graven image of me, of anything, of any likeness, in the heaven above, in the earth beneath, in the water beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor serve them, for I, thy God, thy Lord, is a jealous God. So according to the Old Testament, idol worship is prohibited. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5, verse number 7 to 20, think not that I have come to destroy the law of the prophets. I have come not to destroy, but to fulfill. Whosoever shall break one of the least commandments and teach men to do so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. And whosoever shall keep the commandment shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, in no way shall you enter the kingdom of heaven. That means if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven according to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, you have to follow each and every law of the Old Testament, of Moses, peace be upon him. No making images of Almighty God. Yet they make. Why? All the Christians don't make. The Protestants don't make. Your knowledge of Christians is a bit less. You're a student yet. The Catholics, they make. They make a statue. That's the reason the Protestants, they protest. What you're doing is wrong. So according to the Bible, you should not make images of Almighty God. I agree with you. Most of the Hindus, they do idol worship. And I quoted earlier, Nata Sripate Masti, of that God, there is no pratima. There are no images. There are no sculptures. There are no statues. Brother, do you do idol worship?
I am doing, no.
But you're not following the Veda.
Because I believe in all religion, all they are
believe
same.
All the
God knows, because you know God knows this, all religion.
Brother, if you are believing in all the religions, that means irrespective whether you are following other religion or not, you are not following Hinduism. Brother, you are not following Hinduism.
What I am telling you, God is sleeping now. He knows everything. He created all the earth and heaven. So he knows every religion have their own place, like Islam.
Brother, let's ask one question at a time. There's a big queue there. I will answer your next question. After that, go behind the queue. You are most welcome to ask your question. Fine. You ask that, is God sleeping? Allah gives this answer in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 255. Allah says, Allahu la ilaha al-hayyul qayyum, la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm. That Allah is eternal, absolute, he's self-subsisting. He does not require to sleep. No slumber can seize him, nor does he require rest. You and I require to sleep. You and I require rest. God does not require to sleep. Allah clearly says in the Quran, if he wanted, he could have made each and every human being except Islam submit to the will. If he wanted, very easy. Just kun fayakun. But this is a test for the hereafter. God is testing you. God is testing me. If God wants, he can easily make you not do idol worship. But where is the test? The test is God has given you the rules. Now, do you follow the rule or not? You say you follow all the religions. You're not following Hinduism. You're not following Islam. You're not following Christianity. You're not following Sikhism. You're not following Buddhism. Buddhism, quote me any reference from Dhammapad, from any Buddhist scriptures where Buddha said, make a statue of me. He never said that. Where did he say that? Tomorrow, if any Muslim makes a statue of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, if he makes a statue and calls a Muslim, I say it's wrong. The Prophet never said, make a statue of him. So just because someone diverts and does the wrong thing, whether he's in minority or majority, that does not become the truth. Buddha never said, make a statue of him. So if someone is against the Buddhist sculptures, they're helping the Buddhists follow the religion. So just because they made a big statue of Buddha, that does not mean they're following Buddha. Therefore, I said, if you want to understand religion, don't look at followers. Brother Mahesh, don't look at me. Look at the scriptures. Look at the Quran. Read the Quran. Read the Veda. At least what is common, follow. What is not common, keep it aside. If you say you follow all the religion, you're not following Hinduism. You're not following Christianity. You're not following Islam. Leave aside all. I am requesting you at least follow what is common. What is not common, you can discuss later on. You are not even following what is common. Leave aside following all the religions. So the day you stop doing idol worship, then I can say at least you are following one major part of all the religions. The day you believe in Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as the last messenger, then I can say you are following the two major pillars in most of the major religions. Hope that answers the question.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, brother. Can we have the next question? Is there a brother who is a non-Muslim?
Yeah, good evening, doctor. My name is Jay Majitia. I've completed my engineering this year. And first of all, this is my first time I've been visiting your open talk. And it was really appreciable, the knowledge of all the scripts you have and the confidence you have and lot of Muslim supporters which really follow you. Now, my question to you is a bit political. Now, I would like to ask you, doctor, do you advise all the Muslims to follow the principles of Mahatma Gandhi, like example of non-violence satyagraha, which he fought for us to get an independence from Britishers? As I believe and I respect all the holy books like Quran, Gita, Bible. Apart from that, in today's world, I feel I am more an Indian. So would you advise Muslims to follow principles of Mahatma Gandhi like non-violence, satyagraha, or any of the principles of Mahatma Gandhi?
Brother asked the question that do I suggest the Muslims to follow the principles of Mahatma Gandhi, then he changed it to any principle of Mahatma Gandhi, that is non-violence and satyagraha.
Sorry to interrupt, doctor. Or any of the principles of Mahatma Gandhi.
I got a question. Starting you said the principles, meaning all the principles, then you said any principle, I'll give answer to both. All those principles of Mahatma Gandhi, which match with the Quran, which match with our Creator, matched with the saying of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, I've got no objection telling the Muslims follow it wholesale. For example, the Satyagraha movement of Mahatma Gandhi, non-violence, the Prophet did the same. Not that he copied from Mahatma Gandhi, it is Mahatma Gandhi who copied from the Prophet, which I'll come to it later on. If you see the Makki age of the Prophet, the first approximate 13 years that he spent in Makkah, he told the followers, no violence. Many non-Muslims who accepted Islam, they were fierce warriors. The Prophet said, your jihad is sabr. Sabr means patience. Many Muslims were killed and butchered. The pagan Makkans that time, they targeted the weak Muslims. They tortured them. They killed them. So those who were powerful, they got angry. They said that they killed our brothers, we will take revenge. The Prophet said, your jihad is sabr. See, someone who has the power to fight back, and he fights back, it's good. But someone who has the power to fight back, and the commandment is don't fight back, and then he restrains himself, that is real jihad. Jihad in Arabic means to struggle. It means to strive. So here the Prophet's commandment was non-violence. They went on the streets only saying that we bear witness that there's no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the messenger of Allah. People stoned them, they did not retaliate. People abused them, they did not retaliate. The Prophet went to Taif, people stoned him, he didn't retaliate. So this is one of the strategies, but not the only strategy. So do you want to complete the answer?
No,
sir. So after Dr. Zakir completes the question, we'll allow you to ask. You have some patience, brother.
Okay, sir.
You have asked a question, I have to give the reply. So this part of Mahatma Gandhi, of non-violence, depending on situation. But now if you tell the Indian government, you know the person is robbing, non-violence, don't arrest him. The person is raping, non-violence, don't arrest him. The Indian government will agree. Every country has a police force. This force is meant to let peace prevail in that country. So sometimes they use force against the criminal to let peace prevail. You can't tell the government, can't tell the police commissioner of Bombay that see, Mahatma Gandhi said non-violence. So if a person is robbing, let him rob. Only do shiksha, but don't rob. Suppose they come and rape your sister, you'll say, okay, don't rape, non-violence. So non-violence is the best. In Islam, there is something like zulm. Zulm, in Arabic, the best translation of zulm can be oppression. And a person who does oppression is called as a zalim, zalim person. And who is more zalim than a person who can stop the oppression and does not stop the oppression? The Prophet Muhammad said in the hadith of Sahih Muslim that if you see an evil, you stop it with your hand. If you cannot stop it with the hand, then stop it with the tongue. If you cannot stop it with the tongue, then curse in your heart. And if you curse in your heart, you are the lowest level of mu'min, you are the lowest level of Muslim. Suppose you see a rape taking place. Mahatma Gandhi said, oh, don't rape. The best is if you have the power to stop, stop it with your hand. She may not be your sister. She may not be your mother. If you see someone raping, if you can stop it with your hand, you stop it with your hand. If you cannot, if you are weak, if you don't have the power, at least say, oh, bhai sahab, rape mat karo, balatkar mat karo. Dear brother, don't rape, at least with your tongue. If you think, if I say with my tongue also, he'll kill me, at least curse in your heart. So depending upon the situation, the strategy keeps on changing. When Prophet went to Medina, there he was peaceful. He did Sulh Hudaybiyah. He signed a contract between the pagan, the unbelievers and Muslim. They broke the contract. When they come for war, then the Almighty God said, when they come for war, don't get scared, fight. Kill them. So depending upon the situation, and according to the people, historians, Michael H. Hart, he wrote a book of the 100 most influential people in human history. Number one, he gave to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. But I'm not mentioning him for that. Among the important misses was Mahatma Gandhi. Michael H. Hart, a famous historian, after mentioning the 100 most influential people in history, he mentioned the important misses. And in that, he mentioned Mahatma Gandhi. And he says, the Satyagraha movement of Mahatma Gandhi, which was one of the important movements, which let the Britishers go back. But what he said, even if this movement wasn't there, yet India would have got independence. According to the famous historian, Michael H. Hart. So what we realize, that depending upon the situation, we have to use the strategy. You can't say always non-violence. Sometimes violence will have to be used to let peace prevail. Like how you have police in every country, in every state. So anyone who goes beyond the limits, who rapes, who robs, who harms other people, that time as a last resort, like the country says the police can use force, similarly Islam says as a last resort, as a last alternative, sometimes force can be used to let peace prevail. Hope that answers the question. If I have any other question, you're most welcome, brother.
No, sir, I'm convinced with it, and thanks for the
That's
answer.
The reason I said, don't interrupt me.
Alhamdulillah.
It's my profession. I'm in the field. If I give the complete answer, people are convinced. I start the answer, people want to object. When you're putting your hand up, your mind is going on the question, you aren't paying attention on my answer. So when you listen with an open mind, inshallah, I will answer your question. If not, inshallah, I will give you a second opportunity.
Okay, and I would also like to advise all the Muslim people over here. You have a great scholar like Dr. Naik. So please follow Muslims 100%. As there are some doubts, like people do not follow it 100%. So I hope all the Muslims will follow the Muslim religion 100% and make India proud. Thank you.
Thank you very much, brother. I would request that all the Muslims should follow Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And the last and final revelation, the glorious Quran. As far as the brother, he said that Muslims should follow me 100%. I request him that even he should follow me, at least what I speak about the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. So, brother, we are waiting for an opportunity. I want you also to follow me. Me, as long as I match with the Quran and Sahih Hadith. If I don't match with Quran and Sahih Hadith, even Dr. Zakir Naik is zero. Zakir Naik has got no value. What I say, if it matches with the last and final commandment, the glorious Quran, and last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, you follow me, I request you, even you should follow me, what I speak about the Quran and the Sahih Hadith.
Yes, sister. The next question.
Assalamu alaikum. This is Bhageshri Sawan. I'm a non-Muslim. I want to accept Islam in front of everybody because I want all these people to be on my Shahada on the day of judgment. Ashhadu anna illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadu Rasulullah.
Rasulullah.
MashaAllah, sister.
I think Dr. Zakir can pronounce it properly and she can repeat.
If I say it and you can pronounce it, you can say Ashhadu Allah ilaha.
Ashhadu anna ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashhadu anna. Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu wa Rasuluhu.
Rasulullah.
I bear witness. That there is no God but Allah.
There is no God but Allah.
And Prophet Muhammad.
And Prophet Muhammad,
peace be upon him.
Peace be upon him.
Is the servant and messenger of Almighty God.
Is the servant and messenger of Almighty God.
Welcome to the religion of peace, sister.
Takbir.
Thank you.
Takbir.
We find that in this 10-day conference that we have, this 10-day conference, there are many people who accepted Islam, and many questions were asked to several of the speakers, and they were convinced that this is the only solution for humanity, and we appreciate that, sister. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant you Jannah, peace in this world and the next world, inshallah.
Any questions, sister? You're most welcome to ask.
This non-Muslim sister, she does not want to disclose her identity.
Welcome. Without disclosing her identity, she can ask a question.
She is a student of MBA. She asks, why is Allah referred to Allah? Why not any other name?
The sister asked the question that why is Allah referred to as Allah and why not other names? The reply is given in the Quran in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 110, where it's mentioned in the Quran, قُلْ إِذُ اللَّهُ عَبِدُ الرَّحْمَانِ أَيَّمَا تَدُوا فَلَا الْأَسْمَانُ حُسْنَى Say, call upon him by Allah or call upon him by Rahman. By whichever name you call upon him, to him belong the most beautiful names. You can call Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by any name, but it should be a pure name. It should be a correct name. It should be a name given by himself. And there are no less than 99 attributes given in the glorious Quran and the Sahih Hadith. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Kareem, Al-Hakim, most merciful, most compassionate, most wise, no less than 99. And the crowning one is Allah. And this message that to Allah belong the most beautiful names, besides Surah Isra chapter 17 verse number 110, it's also repeated in Surah Taha chapter number 20 verse number 8, and Surah Araf chapter number 7 verse number 180, and Surah Al-Hashr chapter 59 verse number 24, where Allah says that to him belong the most beautiful name. But the crowning name is Allah. Now, why do we Muslims prefer calling Allah by the Arabic word Allah instead of the English word God? The reason is, sister, all the other names and words, they can be played around with. For example, the English word God, if you add S to God, it becomes gods, plural of God. There's nothing like plural Allah. Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Say he's Allah one and only. If you add D-E-S-S to God, it becomes goddess, a female God. In Islam, there is nothing like male Allah or female Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got no gender. If you add father to God, it becomes godfather. He's my godfather. He's my guardian. There is nothing like Allah Abba or Allah Father in Islam. If you add a mother to God, it becomes godmother. There is nothing like Allah Mother or Allah Ammi in Islam. If you prefix tin before God, it becomes tin God, meaning a fake God. There's nothing like tin Allah in Islam. That's the reason we Muslims, we prefer calling Allah by the Arabic word Allah. And that's the reason this word Allah is also present in most of the major religious scriptures. If you read the 6 scriptures, one of the attributes given to Almighty God is Allah. If you read the Christian Bible, in the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 15, verse 34, in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 27, verse number 46. When Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, when he was put on the cross, he cried out, Allai lama sabaktani. Oh God, why hast thou forsaken me? Does Allai lama sabaktani sound like, oh God, why hast thou forsaken me? No. But if you translate into Arabic, it says, Allah, Allah lama taraktani. Similar. So Hebrew and Arabic, they are sister languages. And if you read the Scofield dictionary, it pronounces Allah also, L-I also is Allah, A-L-A-H. Same. So Allah is even mentioned in the Bible. Even in the Hindu scriptures, it's mentioned in the Vedas. There's a separate Upanishad by the name of Allah Upanishad. So this word Allah is also mentioned by name in the major world religious scriptures. This is the proper name of the true Almighty God. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, brother.
मैं डॉक्टर बलवंत शास्त्री बिहार प्रवासी संघ के मैं राष्ट्रीय अध्यक्ष हूं और बॉम्बे में बहुत दिन से रह रहा हूं आज भी हाशमी आजमी साहब भी हम लोगों के पहचानते हैं कई बार मुलाकात करते हैं आपके अंतर्राष्ट्रीय सम्मेलन में आने के सौभाग्य प्राप्त हुआ इसके लिए सभी भाइयों को मेरा तरफ से नमस्कार
शुक्रिया
मैं एक चीज बहुत उत्सुकता बस मैं कहना चाहता हूं कि हिंदू फिलॉसफी के अंदर में वसुधैव कुटुंबकम वसुधैव कुटुंबकम पूरा पृथ्वी मेरा कुटुंब है परिवार है ऐसा हिंदू फिलॉसफी में कहा है और सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिना सर्वे संतु निरामया मतलब सब सुखी हो सब आनंदित रहे और सब अपने रोजी रोटी कमाते हुए खूब आनंद से रहे यह संदेश हमारे हिंदू फिलॉसफी में दिया है मेरे ख्याल से आपके फिलॉसफी में भी आपके दर्शन शास्त्र में भी इसी तरह के संदेश होगा और इस संदेश को आप लोगों ने समय समय से प्रचार भी किया है लेकिन एक आश्चर्य के साथ में और उत्सुकता बस मैं आपको इंगित करके कहना चाहता हूं कि या तो आप लोगों ने कुरान के सही माने को सही तरीका से विश्व लेवल में रखे नहीं या कुरान के संदेश को यदि आप रखे तो समझने वाला कितना समझा दूसरी बात यह है कि आज पूरे विश्व के अंदर में जितनी प्रतिष्ठा की नजर से कुरान और इस्लाम को जो पहले देखा जाता था कुछ वर्षों से उसमें कमी आई है जैसे कट्टरपंथी चरमपंथी आतंकवाद और कहीं ना कहीं तो मैं क्या समझूं या आपके प्रस्ताव रखने में गलती हुई है या कुरान के सही संदेश पहुंचाया नहीं गया या हम इस संदेश में पड़े हुए हैं कि जो इतना बड़ा कुरान जो भाईचारा के संदेश फैला रहा है चारों तरफ शांति का पैगाम देना चाहता है वह आज विश्व लेवल में और उसकी छवि क्या है धन्यवाद
द ब्रदर आस्क्ड अ वेरी गुड इंपॉर्टेंट क्वेश्चन ही हैज सेड दैट इन हिंदू फिलॉसफी वी बिलीव दैट द फुल वर्ल्ड द होल ह्यूमैनिटी इज लाइक अ फैमिली And everyone should live happily in this family, earn money, live happily, enjoy life. That was his question. Is it similar in Islam? And he says, surely in Islam it will be somewhat similar. And then he comes to his question and asks that this Quran, it should reach the full world. Is there a mistake in the Muslims explaining the Quran? Or is there a mistake in the people understanding it? That today we find Muslims are being labeled as terrorists, as fundamentalists, as extremists. So what is the real problem? As far as the first question, I do agree with him that Hinduism does say that the whole world is a family. We should live happily, earn, enjoy. Islam says somewhat similar, except for the ending. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13, Ya ayyuha nasu inna khalaqnakum min zakrin wa unsa wa jalnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu inna akramakum indallahi atqakum inna allaha alimun khabir. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female. and I've divided you into nations and tribes so that you may recognize each other, not that you may despise each other. So the Quran says that all the humankind has got one common grandparents, Adam and Eve. May Allah be pleased with them both. And Allah has divided us into nations and tribes, different colors, different languages, so that you may recognize each other. And the criteria for judgment in the sight of Almighty God, it's not wealth, it's not caste, it's not color, it's not sex, but it is taqwa. And God Almighty said, most honored, in the same verse of Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse 13, Allah continues and says, and the most honored amongst you is the person who has taqwa. In Hinduism, he said that we have to lead a life happily, earn. In Islam, we have to lead your life happily, yes, but on the basis of taqwa. The only criterion which makes you superior, it is taqwa, it is righteousness, it is God consciousness. It's not money, it's not wealth, it's not sex, it's not caste. Now coming to his question that the Quran is such a good book, is it that there's problem in communication regarding the preachings of Quran, or are we not able to understand? That's the reason, brother, we're having this talk. Islam, the solution of humanity. The problem is in media portraying Islam. And we Muslims, it's our fault. I do agree with you. We aren't expert in media. We Muslims are to blame. As it is the duty of every Muslim to convey the message of Islam, to convey the message of the Quran to the whole of humanity, we aren't doing a full job. We are trying. We are trying a level best. Today, the best way you can reach the masses. Now, see the gathering. Surely hundreds of thousands, I don't know how many. But yet, for us, it is retail. 100,000 is retail for me. We believe in millions. Therefore, we're showing live on the satellite channel. And there's estimated viewership of more than 60 million people watching. 60 million. The 100,000, 200,000 is peanuts. I can give shahada to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have delivered the message to humankind. And 60 million is at least 1%. Yet it is nothing. 1% of humankind, if you count it to be 6 billion. What we want, that we Muslims should be more forward in media. There should be more channels. It should spread much more. And I do agree with you, there is a problem in understanding. That's the reason, as you mentioned, that we are being labeled as extremists, as fundamentalists, as terrorists. And my talk was based on that. That how should you reply when a person says that you're a fundamentalist, you're a terrorist, you're extremist. So hopefully, inshallah, you'll get the translation after this lecture. Hopefully. Hope that answers the question, brother.